Welcome back to TarHeelIllustrated.com. And if you're watching us on our YouTube channel that is called Tar Heel Illustrated, I am THI publisher Andrew Jones. He is THI staff writer and football analyst Brandon Peay. And we are back to continue looking ahead to the Tar Heels football season. We are cramming in a bunch of podcasts here, a bunch of discussions about different position groups as we gear toward the start of fall camp. The Tar Heels report August 1st, first practice is August 2nd, and of course, THI will be there every availability, every open practice, because we go where the Tar Heels go in football and in basketball. And this is a very quick reminder, if you've thought about it and you haven't pulled the trigger yet, or if you don't even know, for $8.33, you can have an annual premium membership, Tar Heel Illustrated. It's a monthly, $8.33 a month. You could be a premium member. What do you get access there to? All of our content, everything that we do. So much of what we do is premium content. Our perspective, our analysis, a lot of the expertise that you get, a lot of the inside information, a lot of intel. You go to the boards and we put a lot of inside, very well sourced things in there that you'll never find on the front page, that you'll never hear in one of these podcasts. So you could become an insider just by joining THI. The other thing that you get, and this might be the greatest plum, because a lot of people are talking about this a lot. They've been telling me how much they love our community, how much it's gotten better in the last couple of years. You could be a member of our message board community. It's a phenomenal community. A lot of people like you, Carolina Tar Heels, who are passionate. You love the Heels. You want to interact with people like you. You know, you talk to people who are Carolina fans at the gym or at the office or something like that, and they just don't know it like you do. They don't know who the names of the recruits are. Who's the backup quarterback? They're asking questions like that. You go to our board, everybody knows that. And they're going to discuss it with you. And they're going to offer thoughtful takes on things. And sometimes you guys may disagree and it may get a little bit frisky in there, but that's okay, because we actually monitor the boards. We'll make sure it doesn't get completely out of hand and it's not too childish. And it's actually fairly respectful. So if you want to be a member of that community and be with a bunch of other passionate and knowledgeable Carolina fans like yourself, head on over there. It's just $8.33 a month for an annual subscription to THI. Brandon, we're here to talk about the wide receivers. We hit on the QBs first. We hit on the running back second. Now it's the wide receivers. I think in a lot of ways, this is the most intriguing position group on the roster, because I love wide receivers with flair. I love wide receivers that have some screw you speed and screw you attitude and screw you toughness in them. And I think that J.J. Jones has shown he's got that. Kobe Pesor has shown he's got that. Gavin Blackwell is showing that that's part of what he could become. We know that Andre Green is dripping with that kind of potential. But guess what? They brought in two new guys. They lost Josh Downs. They lost Antoine Green. They're both in the NFL. But you know what? Tez Walker is a guy that I think perfectly fits what this team's going to do offensively. And so does Nate McCollum. They have two slot guys right now that could catch 70 or 80 passes. But they're going to be on the field at the same time a lot, because Kobe Pesor worked a lot on the outside with McCollum on the inside during the spring, because the objective here is to get your best route runners, pass catchers, speed guys, dudes that produce on the field. They want to go six deep at the minimum. I think they're five right now, very close to a six. I really like this room, Brandon. What are your thoughts about the wide receiver room?
I used to think that wide receivers were just a dime a dozen. Like, you, one graduates, goes on to the NFL, you just plug in the next one and there's really no drop off. But I think a couple of seasons ago, Sam Howell's last year, I think UNC saw how devastating it could be for the offense when you don't have wide receivers who can create separation, find open grass, and ultimately produce. They only have one that could produce, and that just really put a damper on their offense that season. And I think now in 2023, with that lesson that happened in 2021, now in 2023 with the transfer portal and all that, I don't think UNC will ever have lack of depth in that room again. I think they learned their lesson, and I think now that you can just go to a mid-major program and pluck their best receiver away, which will help UNC, I think that's going to keep them competing with the best receivers in the around, you know, the best skill positions around. So I think, yeah, so I think that it's a very good group. And I think the good thing about this group, I think they have a true pecking order. And I think the pecking order is pretty much the same as it was last season, except for the two names at the top. But the names underneath are a year more experience. And I think that's going to really help the group out overall.
Yeah, I'm going to throw some stats really quickly at you guys, just as a little bit of a reminder. J.J. Jones, 24 receptions last year, second most of the guys returning, but he had 434 yards, two TDs, he had a long 74. He had some really tough physical catches. I think he started becoming that guy that they envisioned as the receiver that could get that corner of the end zone touchdown when you need to. With one of those over-the-shoulder throws where you get inside the defender, you keep the feet inbounds. I think J.J.'s becoming that kind of guy. Kobe Pesor, 29 catches, 324 yards, four TDs, a long of 49 yards. But think about the three games Josh Downs missed. FAMU, App State, and Oregon. Most of Kobe's production was in those games. He filled in for him, and he did very, very well. So I thought that that was a real good indicator of what we're going to see a lot more of this year from him, even if he's on the outside a lot. He'll still play a lot on the inside too. Gavin Blackwell, 18 catches, 239 yards, a TD, a long of 36 yards. And then two transfer portal guys that you alluded to, Tez Walker from Kent State, 58 catches, 921 yards, 11 TDs, led the Mid-America Conference. I think he was second nationally, 11 TDs, long of 56 yards. And by the way, the only first half touchdown scored against Georgia last season. He had a big game in Athens. Nate McCollum, Georgia Tech, 60 catches, 655 yards, three TDs, 56 yards was his longest. But let's remember, he played 11 games because he did not play in the game in Chapel Hill. And he had three different starting quarterbacks. And I've kind of made this joke, and I don't mean to be disrespectful or anything like that, but none of those guys are on any preseason lists. Mm-hmm. So he was running routes, trying to get the ball from quarterbacks at a completely different level than what he's dealing with Drake May, Bhopal, right? With Drake May. So he's in a much better situation. He's got better receivers around him. This is a really, really deep group. When I say deep, it's not like they're going 10 deep. But if you have five guys that could be 40 or 50 catch guys, that's deep. That means you could spread that thing around. I thought the offense bogged down at times 2 years ago, in part because everybody focused on Josh Downs. Look at Josh Downs' per game numbers in 2021. He was highly productive the first half of the season, was scoring multiple touchdowns, catching a ton of passes, and the yardage was high. That started to drop in the second half of the year because everybody focused on him so much. I thought Carolina started relying on him too much late last season, and the offense started to slow some. That's not going to be an issue this year. I think those five guys I mentioned can all be counted on, and then you throw in the Andre Green factor. Andre Green might be the most talented in that group, but he's got to become more consistent with everything he does. He can't run a great route one snap and the next snap run the wrong route or not catch the ball or just not be sharp in his cuts or anything like that. He has to be consistent with everything he does. And when he gets there, a lot of people on the staff believe that he could be an exceptional wide receiver at the college level and maybe even have a career after college. So your thoughts, Brandon, about what I said about these guys, some of the numbers, what are you sort of envisioning with this group? Three running off the field, three running on, and they could run the same stuff. They don't have to change what they do.
So as far as the numbers you named, I think a lot of them are going to you said they can get four or five guys that have 40 to 50 catches. I think that might be a little hard for them to do because I do think they're going to run the ball more, and I think Bryson Nesbitt and Kamari Morales are going to have their catches too. So I think it's going to be hard to get that many people, 40 to 50, that many receivers, 40 to 50 catches, but I do think they'll be better. They'll definitely be better overall as a group. So they might be more, I think the drop rate, they didn't have a high drop rate last season, but I think like stuff like the drop rate will go down. I think you'll see better routes. I think you'll see less double coverage on certain people because you have to respect everybody that's out there. So I don't know if the improvements will show up in the numbers, but I do think the improvements will show up with how many players have above 25 catches and how many, like the production. I think more people are going to have a seat at the table, more people are going to eat, but I just don't think anybody's plate is going to be as full as it was previously.
I should have clarified 40 to 50 potential, I could see the first five on this. I could see Jones, Pacer, Blackwell, Walker, McCollum, all 40, 50 catches or more. I could see them all having those kind of seasons. I don't think they're going to have five guys with 50. I think that's a hell of a lot to ask. But I don't think 35 plus is too much to ask. When you think about Pacer last year, in three games, those three games he started when Downs was out there, I think he caught 23, 24 passes. I think you can see each of these guys have huge games. You could see an 8-catch, 130-yard game from those five at some point this coming season. Now, is Andre Green, does he become the sixth one that does it? What that does, it makes game planning really, really difficult for opponents. It really affects coverage because when you've got to keep – it's like the basketball team. We're saying, well, you know what? They're going to be a more spread team. They're going to have guys that can handle the ball at the one spot, the two spot, the three, maybe even the four. Harrison Ingram's the four. So defenses have to honor all five guys on the floor. It's going to open things up for a lot more fluidity. I think the route running could be the same way. Teams can't overemphasize any one guy because someone else will beat you. Then you throw in the tight end element to this. Mm. And then Drake's ability to run if something does break. You know, you only have 22 eyeballs on defense. And it seems like if these guys are playing at a level that the potential says they can, you need 30 or 35 eyeballs on defense. That's what creates issues for other teams. I think the potential of doing that with this group is there.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. And the more that you can spread, like you said earlier, the more you spread it around, the harder it is for opposing teams to game plan for you. And we saw last season how it looks when you become easy to game plan for. So I think the more that they can spread the ball around, that's receivers, running backs, tight ends, the more they can spread it around, the more people to touch the ball, the overall, it's going to be an overall positive for North Carolina for sure. They need to get more people involved with the ball this season.
All right, let's talk a little bit about the newcomers, the portal newcomers, Tez Walker. I think most Carolina, I think the ones that we were saying need to be on the message board, I think they all know who he is. And people talk about him on the message board every day, just about, by the way. The more casual fan may not know who he is. So if there's a more casual fan that's listening right now, you've seen Tez Walker up close. You were on the field for the spring game. So what are your thoughts about him? What is the thing that popped to you right away when you saw him that the casual fan should look for when Tar Heels play South Carolina September 2nd?
So I'm not a real big fan on hyping players up before they got to play on this level before, but I think when you see them, it's the size and speed combination. The guy, and you can see when they're playing seven, when they were doing 7-on-7, when they were scrimmaging 11-on-11, you can see who Drake May has the most trust in is clearly Tez Walker because he's going to look for him because he's the best player out there. He's a, like I think I said this to you at the spring game. He looks like an SEC guy. He looks like a guy that could be playing at Georgia, that could be playing at Alabama. He looks like a guy that could be a first round draft pick. He has all the physical talent. I'm interested to see how his game translates to the Power Five level, if he can do it consistently against Power Five competitions. But I don't think that should be an issue for him at all.
Yeah, he had a huge game at Georgia last year, and I know that I've pointed that out a lot. And like when I talk about Elijah, I was going to talk about the Mississippi State game or something like that. Remember, that's just a one-off. It's just one game. It's one thing to have one really good game against that kind of caliber. And Georgia wasn't focused that day. They weren't ready to go. That was a tight game for a while. They could have, in a normal game, but look what they did to TCU. They only beat Kent State 39-22. So that may have been part of it as well. And I'm not trying to take it away from him. I think we just have to have an honest look at it. You're right. It's game by game against ACC corners. He's going to face SEC corners the first game. He's going to face Big Ten corners in the third game. And then he's going to face ACC corners in eight games, including guys at Clemson and State at the end of the year. Some pretty good Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh has a lot of DBs that have gone on to the league. So I think that's going to be interesting to see how that works out. It's going to be the consistency. Is he going to put up big numbers but be a guy that goes 12 catches for 180 one game and he goes 2 for 9 the next game? Or is he going to be in that 5-plus, 6-plus every game and he gets you that 25 or 30-yarder down the middle of the field that moves the chains, that gives the offense an injection when they need it? it's going to be interesting to see how he accumulates the total stats that he ends up building, because he's going to put up numbers. Yeah. How does he get there with those numbers? Yeah. That to me is going to be really interesting.
Yeah, because with wide receivers, they can you can have one breakout game and really make your overall season stats look a lot better than what they are. But I do think I think guys that come from the lower level up to this level, I think they have a chip on their shoulder, something to prove. I'm sure he, in his head, he's trying to prove to people that he can do it consistently at this. He wants to show people. So I mean, if he can do it, it will be done. I'm gonna go on to Nate McCollum. I think getting a guy like Nate McCollum is really good for Carolina, because they lost Josh Downs, and I know they have Kobe Paceor, but like you said, you just want to get as many good players as you can, and to get a good receiver, a good proven receiver that was within your conference. So you got a scout on them already. You've seen them before. To get a guy like that, and we saw him at the spring game. I thought he popped. I thought he made a lot of plays during the spring game. He had that controversial catch in the back of the end zone. I think a guy like him, along with Tez Walker, I think those two can really come into Carolina right away and just like pick up where Josh Downs and Antoine Green left off.
The thing that struck me about watching Nate McCollum and some of the 7-on-7, 11-on-11 things I saw practice in the spring game is he's that kind of receiver that defenses lose in the middle of the field. Yeah. He can get open in the middle of the field. Like, the linebacker's still like, where the hell did he go?
Yeah,
and the safety's not sure where he is. And there he is, 12 yards, turns up field, picks up five or six more, gets you an 18-yard pickup. He's that kind of guy. And it's interesting because Carolina fans that watched every game last year, you didn't see him in the Georgia Tech game because he didn't play that game, which is interesting. And they still beat Carolina, which was the black mark on the season last year. But he still had 60 receptions. If you saw Georgia Tech play at all, you saw how miserable the quarterback situation was. And he was certainly keyed on by defenses. They didn't run the ball super well. They just weren't very good offensively. But I think 60 catches, and we were talking about catch numbers a little while ago, in 11 games, on a team that fired its head coach in the middle of the season, had an interim head coach, had quarterback issues galore, and really – didn't have great spirit until there was a change in the middle of the season. I think that says a lot. I think that says a lot about Nate McCollum. I think he's a guy that could come in and very quietly, six catches, 85 yards, seven catches, 90 yards. And everyone's thinking about Tez Walker with the big play, or J.J. Jones with the dramatic catch in double coverage down to the 4-yard line. It sets up a TD. But consistency, I think, is going to be what McCollum brings this team. I wonder that about Blackwell. I don't think that's going to be an issue with McCollum, and maybe because we've seen him in Power 5 football already, and he's done it there already. But he's going to be one of those guys that they know. I was talking about dudes in the running back room they could put on the board and count on. I think the staff knows they could put Nate McCollum's name on the board and say, we could count on this guy every game to give us something we need. And I think that's a huge plus. I love the two pickups in the portal. They fit perfectly. They complement one another. And I think that they've already built a real connection and some tremendous chemistry with Drake May, and they're not even in fall camp yet. So I think this is a good pickup. So let me ask you, because we've gone those guys, I want to ask about Andre Green. Because Lonnie Galloway says, going to have six. Chip Lindsey says, I want six. And then he wants to run those six out there. We've been talking about five. Andre Green would be the sixth. Do you think Andre Green at some point this year becomes that sixth guy? Because I'm not sure he's penciled in as a sixth guy when fall camp opens, Brandon.
Yeah, I think he might be. I think Andre Green is if he's not in there now, I think eventually he will be that sixth guy. And if Andre Green's your sixth guy, I think you're in pretty good shape. I don't know. I haven't been around him too much, but I think my suspicion is he's a guy that's a gamer. Like, he might not do the little things in practice that gets him up on the depth chart, but eventually we need somebody to go out there and he'll go out in the game situation and just make a big play. We saw he played well in the Oregon game. Yeah. So if he can just take that confidence and, you know, roll it over to
He showed some of that there, Brandon. What you're talking about? Yeah. He showed some of that in the Oregon game.
Yeah, it's like lights are on, time to perform, right?
Yeah, I watched him a lot. The press box, it was at a baseball stadium, so we're kind of in the corner of the end zone. I can't stand that. It's like that at Miami, too, because that used to be where the Marlins played. But I watched him a lot. I watched his mannerisms. I watched how he interacted on the field. And he looked really confident and comfortable in between snaps. He didn't look indecisive. Looked like he knew what he was doing. Like all the growing and becoming a college football player, all that had taken place.
Yeah.
And now it's just a matter of consistent performance. I think a lot of those other things are there. And let's remember, he did have a lower back issue last year for a while that slowed his development. And he was a late arrival as well. He was a summer arrival. So he was catching up for a while. I agree with you. I think that he will eventually be one of those six. And maybe he's a guy that doesn't produce a ton, but he'll have a couple of those, oh, wow, moments.
Yeah, yeah.
And his time to really stack numbers might be in year three and year four.
Yeah, and I was going to say, if he is a guy that has a – if it clicks, if the light bulb comes home for him in year two, I mentioned the pecking order earlier. He's a guy that will, if it clicks, he's going to shake up the pecking order. The whole pecking order that I mentioned earlier is going to be shaken up, and we don't know how the receivers will be ranked, but he will definitely shake it up if he can get that light bulb to go off.
I don't know who the starting three is going to be. I don't know if they start Pesor outside. They may start JJ Jones outside because it's sort of the natural matchup order, if you will. But Pesor is going to play a ton outside. He's going to play a ton inside. I think you're looking probably at J.J. Jones, Tez Walker, and Nate McCollum as your three starting receivers, and Pesor is going to get starter reps. He could start on the outside over J.J. Jones, but they like J.J. J.J. needs to kind of take a big step forward. He was trusted as a true freshman some 2 years ago, in part because they had to play somebody because they were really struggling to get guys to produce. Justin Olsen played a lot of snaps 2 years ago. He needs to take a big step forward, but I think they're the four at first that you know are going to play a lot of snaps. Blackwell will play a lot, but I think his snap totals will be below what that first four will be. And then, of course, we'll see how Green comes along.
Yep, I agree. I tend to agree with that with that order. Yeah, I agree with that. I think J.J. Jones in that third slot just makes a lot of physical sense from a physical standpoint. So I think that alone kind of gives him the leg up. But like we were talking about Andre Green earlier, if he steps up from now until August, we could very well see him in that third position.
Yeah, I don't know if it'll be right away, but I think for him, we'll close on this because a lot of people, fans are like, well, what happened to the four-star guy? Why isn't Andre Green playing more? I get that all the time. Is Andre Green going to break out this year? I don't know if he's going to break out this year. What I think more than expecting a breakout from him, I think this is going to be a bridge year to his third season, and he breaks out in his third season. He's going to get enough reps. He's going to have enough success. He's going to do some stuff that is head-scratching that he'll see on film and he'll work on. And it's his third year when they really need him to step forward and explode. I think that's when he really takes off. But he can still be productive this year, and it may be a thing that builds over the course of time.
Yeah, I agree with that.
All right. That's our wide receiver talk. Let us know what you think, guys. What is your starting three in the first game? And when do you think Andre Green will break out if he breaks out this year? Let us know. The best place to do that is in the thread where we post the article on our message board. Not the free board, guys, the premium board. The premium board. That's where the respectful, intelligent discourse takes place. I'm not saying it does it on the free board, much more so on the premium board. That's the best place to go. And it's just $8.33 a month, plus you get everything else. So come on over and become a part of our community today. He's Brandon Peay. I'm Andrew Jones. We appreciate y'all stopping by.
Thanks.